Just how frightened have government and management been by the wave of strikes?
Well, one of the managers I spoke to said he was terrified by having to face 2,000 workers who are shouting their demands, and more terrified by the fact that these workers didn't respond when he spoke. Expected an instant response to say yes or no, or we'll accept only 10%, or we'll negotiate, or something on this basis. Every wage dispute turns into racial confrontation. This is quite obvious. When I've been at one textile factory, the workers shouted, "Bulala mlungu." This is some of the workers outside who also were drunk, but they were shouting, "Balalum lungu," which means kill the whites.
The energy which fired the Durban strikers was the energy of despair. The average black worker in the city earns about £7 a week. £10 is the officially accepted poverty minimum wage. And even that makes no allowance for medicine, school fees, savings, or recreation. The strikes hit Durban at the end of its hot summer season, when whites from many parts of South Africa were still disporting themselves along the city's Golden Mile. While black workers confronted police in another part of town, and while the government were being accused in Parliament of fiddling while Durban burned, sun worshippers on the whites-only beaches were tanning themselves to an acceptable shade of brown. But they could scarcely fail to notice what was happening just a few streets away and the international headlines which their strike-bound city had made.
I mean, this happened all over the world, that people strike for more money and I think that it happened in the past and will happen in the future as well.
Did it seem to you, from what you could find out about it, that they had any justification in what they were doing? The strikers?
Most probably.
So you think that have they got enough to live on?
Not all. Some of them have, some haven't. And those that, there are lots of them who don't appreciate what they're getting. If you go to a race course, you will see more Africans backing horses and Europeans. They waste an awful lot of money at the beer halls also. I mean, these people, they will brandish sticks, which is not necessary. Why must they use sticks and iron bars and things like it to get what they want? There's no need for that. Why can't they come quite like all Europeans do when they have that little strike?
Why do you think the immediate situation happened, the immediate wave of strikes recently?
I don't know. You can only go by what you read in the newspaper. Yeah.
But you live here, you must know a bit more than that.
Oh, there's some things I know, I just keep to myself.
But do you think that the strikes were justified in any sense?
I don't know.
What do you think's going to happen now?
Well, they normally get their wage the month, you know, normally get an increase in salaries and, you know, last for another few years and they'll strike again, get another increase, that's all.
Do you think that it would prevent this kind of disturbance happening if they had their own trade unions?
Yeah, it probably would prevent it. But mind you, then it will get to England's extreme, striking every week. You know, trade unions probably, that's probably communist control.
Yeah.
Probably communist backing there, which is probably not over here. Just black agitators here.
The charge that agitators were behind the strikes was made by the Minister of Labour himself. That charge has been widely criticised by English language newspapers. One of them replied that the real agitation was in the black workers' bellies. In any case, the strikes were so widespread, affecting nearly every kind of manufacturing and service industry, that it's hard to see who could have masterminded them. The biggest group of strikers was the city's 16,000 municipal workers. What they demanded was an increase of £2.50 on an average wage of £6 a week. What they got was a £1 minimum increase under threat of being sacked if they stayed out. But to have pushed the Durban authorities even that far was no small advance for men who, under South Africa's labour laws, are not even classified as workers, let alone given the right to form unions and to bargain.
Well, initially, the municipality decided to try and negotiate in the way that one would with white workers. Now, please don't misunderstand me. I don't mean this in any way against the African, but we found we couldn't negotiate. His ways are simple ways, and when we spoke of percentage increases and increases to follow in at a later date and more the type of negotiation one might carry out with a white trade union, he didn't understand it. He just did not understand.
Isn't the obvious solution to allow Africans to form trade unions?
Yes, one would, I think, come to that conclusion normally, but you know, here again, the African is not a very sophisticated man at this stage, and there is a danger of misuse of trade unions, of the control of the trade unions at this stage of their development getting into wrong hands. But without a doubt, this is a problem we have, and this is one we will have to sort out very soon.
Do you think that, can you see the day when Africans will be able to form trade unions?
I believe it will have to happen, but it may have to be sooner than we have thought. This is the sort of thing that we must now think about and decide upon.
Some of the critics of what's been happening here say that it proves that Durban and South Africa as a whole are societies that have grown rich by exploiting black labour. How do you react to that charge?
Well, I have to say that in some instances that is maybe so. I think in fairness it is so, but not as a general thing. Not as a general thing. I've been alarmed to read about one or two of our bigger organizations, the low wages that they are paying to the African, but then they are less than half of what we pay, for example, in the municipality. So I don't think that one can generalize like that, but say there are cases where your point would probably be correct.
An increase in bus and rail fares was one immediate cause of the strikes. Workers who live in the black township of Claremont may pay 50 pence in fares from a weekly pay packet of less than £4. Nearly all of Claremont's workers are employed in the textile industry by a group who've been under attack as the worst exploiters of black labour in the whole Durban area. The Frame Group is South Africa's third largest employer. Mr. Frame made it quite clear to me personally that his deep distaste for self-advertisement would not allow him to give us an interview. However, he has an even deeper distaste for the kind of publicity that he's been receiving in the press. So after weeks of silence, he issued a remarkable statement. Remarkable on two counts. Firstly, in that he issued it at all. And secondly, for what it actually contains. There is, of course, some self-justification. He disputes the charge that he pays lower wages than his competitors. And he claims that he spent so much in the past year on training new workers that one group of his factories has actually run at a loss. On the other hand, he also says this: I certainly share the collective responsibility of guilt which all white South Africans bear. And at another point, I believe that everyone from the Prime Minister down, and I of course include myself, has learned a lesson from the past few weeks. We now all have to take stock and do some deep and hard thinking. One obvious subject for hard thinking is whether to allow black trade unions. Already, some white union leaders are defiantly organizing black workers into benefit societies. But on the question of full union rights for blacks, most white workers, like their employers, are reluctant to lose the privileges of apartheid. They hold the skilled jobs in industry, and they earn six times what black workers get.
I think that white workers are very self-interested and self-concerned. On the other hand, they are beginning to recognize black power. Black power in the sense of the strike situation, say now. And whereas before, white workers would be able to insult African workers at will and call them black kaffirs and all kinds of derogatory racial phrases, you'll find that black workers are now replying in the same vein and saying and replying and swearing back and saying, "You white bastards, you're just sitting on your ass all day. We are actually doing the work," because this is what the whites are saying about them. On the whole, however, the wage gap between black and whites is growing. It's not slowing down, it's in fact getting wider and wider. And in this vacuum, the tension that is being created by this increase in inequality is creating a black militancy. And I feel that white workers are beginning to recognize that their black boy has also to feed a family and also has to make a living. And I feel there is some goodwill here, but you have to, it's the kind of goodwill where you've got to knock him on the head first, and then he'll come around to realizing something has to be done.
In Durban, white goodwill includes this advice center at the headquarters of three big trade unions. Although black workers are not allowed to join these unions, they've been coming here in increasing numbers since the strikes, often with disturbing stories of what's happened to them since they made their protest.
Could I ask Michael what the complaint is in this case?
Well, the complaint here, this first speaker has been pointing out that he was one of the person who were elected by the workers in the factory to represent them to the management. Now, what has happened, obviously, he has been dismissed.
It's after the strikes?
After the strikes, see. Now, he come here, whether we can help him or to clarify this issue of, he was elected by the people, because they went on the strike, then the management said we must elect the committee, and he was one of the person who was elected to represent him to the management. To his surprise now, he is one of those who have been disfired.
Does he feel that he was fired because he was a spokesman during the strike?
This is how he feels, yes.
The advice center has heard many similar stories since the strikes ended. And the government's new banning orders have silenced several other voices which had identified themselves with the strikers. One of them is Streeny Moodley, a coloured student leader. Since this interview was filmed, he's been placed under house arrest for 5 years.
Well, one of the objects of the South African Students' Organization is to work in the black community. That is to develop the sense of awareness, to develop a sense of self-reliance, to develop, in fact, the black community's abilities, to develop them so that they can reach a position where they can, in fact, begin to stand up on their own and do things for themselves, and not have things done for them, and not get handouts from the white liberal community.
Do you think that the recent wave of strikes here has in any way advanced that cause?
I think in time to come, black people are going to be very much more organized than they are now. And this is basically one of the reasons that the wildcat strikes tended to not have the real punch that could escalate it and make all blacks throughout the country begin to realize what in fact is happening in South Africa. Although they do realize, they feel that white society has too much of a hold on them, and therefore they refrain from taking on, adopting any kind of action.
What kind of risks are involved for people like yourself who are putting forward this philosophy?
Well, I haven't really given that any consideration, but I would think that our stand, in a sense, has made white society look at us as agitators, you know. And I don't think we are, in fact, agitators, and I don't think we're concerned about the risks that are involved. What we are concerned with is seeing to it that what black people want, they should get.
Trade union leader Harriet Bolton also sympathized openly with the strikers. I asked whether the apparent hunt for scapegoats now would make it impossible for future black leadership to develop.
The leaders are there. We've discovered excellent leadership, but they learnt a lesson when African trade unions were being thought about and formed previously. You see, Africans didn't want to stick their necks out and start to form unions because they had tried this previously and their leaders had been dealt with, and then there was this communication gap between Robben Island and the mainland.
Robben Island prison?
Yes. Robben Island is that island where many of the people who were active in political and trade union movement activities some years ago were detained when the government made a clean sweep. So I think that that was a lesson that people learnt, and they the leadership is there. It's active. It's some of it is very, very good and has potential, but it won't. They won't show their hands until such time as the government recognises trade unions.
There are top-level talks taking place at present between government and business leaders concerning the whole labour situation. How hopeful are you of the results that may come from those talks?
Well, I'm afraid I'm a bit cynical about those attempts. I'd like to see results. I'd like to actually see them. Because from the general discussions with employers, that they all seem to think that something should be done, but nobody actually starts at home. That's a bit unkind. Few people actually start at home. I think the general consensus of opinion from the public is that something must be done, but nobody wants to do it. It mustn't come out of their pockets. Somebody somewhere must pay more, not them.
Various increases have been granted since the strikes in various industries. Do you think they'll make much difference?
No, I think that they have, hunger has driven them back, and the prospects of hunger has driven them back to work. They've gone back in the meantime because they're not really aggressive people. They really are people crying out for help and not knowing how else to do it, having no other method of communication. This also came out in the meetings. For instance, a man said that we are not striking. We repeat, we're not striking. We only stop work so that you can notice us. We have tried to speak to our employers, but they didn't hear us with words, and so now we're stopping work, and this they notice. Now we hope that they can see our struggles and they can understand them.
When you look at the whole recent wave of strikes here, do you feel that the black workers have won a victory?
I don't think they intended to win. I don't think they thought about it like that at all. And I don't think they won. But I think what has happened, and it's something that nobody's going to be able to take back, is that workers have visualized how many of them are in the same boat, how many of them are thinking in the same way. And I think this has been the most important thing. The money's been a pittance, really, when you consider prices and when you consider the difference in white and black wages. The money hasn't been important, but the consciousness that will have come to these workers from this action is very important. And I think this can't be taken back, it can't be cancelled out.
But in a black township like Claremont, that consciousness is bitter and despondent. The textile mills of Philip Frame employ most of the men and women in this Durban shantytown. Some have been paid off recently, declared redundant when the strikes ended. And those who've been kept on, with an average weekly increase of £1, are still earning much less than the official poverty minimum of 20 rand or £10 a week. And what do you earn?
Tola Malina in a factory. She gets 5 rands a week.
5 rands a week. And have you a family? Are you married? Have a family?
She has got a lot of children. She has got five children.
To keep, this is on 5 rand a week, £2.50.
That's right.
Now, what does she do? How does she feed them?
She maintain on this 5 rand. Well, anyway, she has got to give them poor food. She buys poor food just because to in order to feed these children.
Can what kind of food would she like to be able to buy for them that she can't?
She prefer some nice food too, like rice, eggs, and some nice food that give proteins, you see. But she can't manage to buy it because of the poor wages she gets.
How much money do they think they would consider is a fair wage?
From 20 rand a week. Because the food is very costly. The cost of living is very high.
So if they got 20 rand a week, that's £10 a week, they would say that's a fair wage.
That's better. They say, it can be better. and yeah. better. But 30 rands is much better.
Yeah. Now, what were they getting, these men over here? Apart from our friend, what were these men getting when they were working before they lost their job?
Seven rand.
They were getting 7 rand a week.
Do they think after the strike now, and having lost their jobs because of the strike, that it was all a waste of time, or do they maybe think that they have in some way frightened the white employers? What do they feel?
Manje umnumzane lo uyabuza ukuthi njengoba manje iteleka lezi seyiphelile sokuma kwazo njengoba yimayile nje.
Awukho. It was all a waste of time.
It's just a waste of time, you say.
Ningabuyela kanjani sentsuku amapha?
Just a waste of time. They will never take them back again.
If there is one public figure in South Africa whom the black workers of Durban respect, it is the chief executive of their Zulu homeland, Chief Gacha Buthelezi. He is the only black leader with the authority to argue their case with the South African government.
The Prime Minister and various business leaders have publicly said that they have learned lessons from the strikes. What kind of lessons do you hope they may have learned?
First of all, that, you know, we are human beings too, you know. That even if we are the powerless in this country, we are human beings, and that although we cannot be said to have a real voice in the affairs of our country, that in spite of that, we can make ourselves heard, as the strikers have done recently. So I think on a wide basis, this I would think is the lesson they have learned.
So it's not simply a question of higher wages, it's not simply a matter of money?
I think it's much more than that. Because this question of low wages is tied up, as I said, basically with this question, are we human beings or not? If we are, then we require the same amount of money to maintain life as any other human being in any part of the world. The trouble is that I think most people in South Africa tend not to accept us as full human beings, you know. They think we're just some units or subhuman creatures that the Almighty places at their disposal, you know, to work for them, you know, with their cheap labor.
Do you think there's any possibility of a change in that, even as a result of the recent strikes, where people saw that because they didn't know what their own workers were thinking, the city was grinding to a halt?
Well, I hope they've learned that lesson, really, because if they don't, you see, it's obvious that if any flare-ups of this sort take place, there'd be much, much more worse than this. And one can never know, even the calmness that we command now, whether it'll exist all the time. One can never guarantee, because we can never predict these things. So that I hope that God the Almighty will help South Africa to learn this lesson, that they have got to communicate at all levels.
Is there much time left?
Well, it's difficult to judge that, but even this strike demonstrates that, you know, we don't have unlimited time as we tend to think. You know, there's an expression which people often utter in this country, that there's no hurry in South Africa. You know, and in Afrikaans they say alles sal reg kom, meaning all will come right at the end, you see. And this sort of sums up, you know, their attitude, you know, their sort of laissez-faire attitude of not doing something about problems, you know, because they'll sort of sort themselves out without anyone trying.
And you would see this current labor situation as some kind of milestone, would you?
I think it is a milestone. I certainly think so. Whether things go better or worse, it certainly is that.